In this season of sharing and connecting, no gift is more perfect than a new Samsung Galaxy S7 or Galaxy S7 Edge, unless it's two. That's right, buy one Galaxy S7 or Galaxy S7 Edge at Sprint and get a second one free, twice the nice at one low price. So dash to a Sprint store, sprint.com/holiday, or call 1-800-SPRINT-1 today and get two gifts to make spirits bright.
Coverage and offer not available everywhere, subject to credit and $30 activation fee. GS72896 and Edge 3313 per phone for 24 months with installment billing. Second phone free after monthly credits. Requires new lines. Taxes due at sale. Early termination results on remaining balance due. Excludes 50% off line. Restrictions apply.
Blog Talk Radio.
Spectrum Technique. Special technique of shadow boxing.
What's going on? We are here live, once again live, on the Boxing Source Radio Show on Go Long Media. I am your host, James Bell, lead boxing analyst for the Cohort Truth on Sports. That is at thechtonsports.com. Once again, thechtonsports.com. You'll be able to catch a few articles here and there in the sport of boxing, among other sports. Number to dial in to talk boxing is 347-237-5539. Once again, 347-237-5539. Press the one key to get on queue. You'll be able to talk live on the show. We have few things that we're going to be going over within the sport, as we had a boxing card on HBO Sports. Going on there, so we'll be going over that particular card, among other things. But before we get into that, just want to mention here the opening of the show. Be sure to catch the sister shows on Go Long Media, starting with the Cohort Truth on Sports Tuesdays at 8:30 p.m. with the Executioner, Matthew Long, as the host, and also Wednesdays at 8:30, you have the CMT Firestorm Football Talk Show with Callie Mike as the host, talking about NFL and college football. But right now, here on December 18th, we're going over what happened last night. We had something going on in Los Angeles. So I'm going to start with actually the Cruiserweight co-feature that happened, as we had Alexander Usyk, who recently won a world title belt there against Krzysztof Łuki, by decision. And with that happening, he was defending that WBO cruiserweight title, and he was in there in the pretty much in a kind of a stay busy bout there at cruiserweight. He recently won the belt against Krzysztof Łuki in his 10th professional fight. And then he went here in the former Inglewood, California, to go up against Tabiso Runtunu, who was 17-2. He did have a win back in 2014 against Garrett Wilson for the NABF Cruiserweight title, and did win earlier this year to win an interim WBA regional belt, but then went up against Oleksandr Usyk. And it was pretty much a kind of like a fight that kept Usyk busy. Tunu was a guy that, like a lot of people who were in the boxing thing, pretty much said that was, you know, someone that kind of like gives his opponents different looks, kind of hard to catch, you know, early on, kind of like a slick puncher boxer. Yeah, slick puncher slash boxer. And I would say gave Usyk a fairly hard time. I mean, I think that, you know, people thought that Usyk would probably beaten Tunu fairly significantly. He had a, you know, massive height advantage, size advantage too, but it was just a matter of catching up to him and, you know, trying to get to him. So, you know, with that being known, that's something where he would have to kind of, he had to like make adjustments in order to, you know, get the upper hand on him sooner. And he eventually got to him later on in the fight. He was able to score a knockdown against Mtunu and then eventually scored the knockout victory over Mtunu with, you know, at the 1:52 mark in round 9. It was, you know, near shutout victory up to that point. You know, you had Usyk there, you know, weighing in at 199.5 pounds, and Tunu at 198.5 pounds. But like I was saying before, I mean, you had Oleksandr Usyk that was coming in the ring at 6'3", while Tabiso Tunu was coming in there at 5'11". So there was like a 4-inch height advantage for Oleksandr Usyk. So he is, so Usyk stays undefeated there, at 11 wins, no losses. And Tabiso Runtunu goes to 17-3. Usyk looks like he is, coming out there as the number one cruiserweight. As like I was saying before, he got that victory over Krzysztof Głowacki earlier this year to win that world cruiserweight title belt. And you know, he's basically, you know, the man who beat the man as Usyk, you know, beats Głowacki, who beat Marco Huck. And Marco Huck was being, you know, universally recognized as the guy that was number one person in the cruiserweight division. So you have Oleksandr Usyk getting that win over Tabiso Runtunu to retain the WBO World Cruiserweight title. Moving on, they actually had something in between that bout and the Hopkins-Joe Smith Jr. bout, and that was the Joseph Diaz versus Horacio Garcia. This was for a minor featherweight championship. You had the NABF featherweight championship there, as you had Joseph Diaz coming in there at 22 wins with no losses. and Horacio Garcia are there with 30 wins, one loss, and one draw. And that draw came in his last fight. Of course, you had here Diaz. This is his, I would say, his fourth defense of that NABF title. He's actually in the fourth fight that he's had in 2016. He fought March, he fought in July, he fought in September, and then pretty much 3 months later, he's fighting here once again. He scored a good TKO win earlier in the undercard of the Canelo Alvarez fight against Andrew Cancillo. And then they have him staying busy here with another fight 3 months later against Horacio Garcia. And this was something where he basically, you know, outboxed Garcia for 12 rounds. He didn't necessarily, you know, have much of a difficult fight against Horacio Garcia, but it was just something where he was, you know, able to stay warm and, you know, get the unanimous decision win to stay there in contention in the featherweight division that's, you know, fairly deep. I don't necessarily feel that he's going to get those big shots quite yet, but you might see him here coming up in 2017, kind of like moving up the ranks within the featherweight division. Before I get into the summary of the main event there, I have area code 202 here with me. What's going on with you?
Hey, what's going on? It's World Rank. How you feel?
Doing good here, World Rank. Just, you know, getting in this show here before the end of the year. I'm probably going to, you know, of course, skip next week. And then after that, it'll be, you know, 2017. So this is fairly saying that this is going to be the last show of the 2016 season. So like right here, I'm going to just move on to that main event that happened at the Forum in Los Angeles. We had a main event there with Bernard Hopkins against Joe Smith Jr. This was at the light heavyweight division. Was for a minor light heavyweight title there in the WBC. Of course, Bernard Hopkins coming in there with as his last fight of his career. That was his 67th professional fight. It's been in the game about 20 years, but he did have more than a two-year hiatus since his last fight where he went up against the went up against Sergey Kovalev while putting up many of the world light heavyweight titles there, you know, in Boardwalk Hall. And he lost a clear unanimous decision against Sergey Kovalev. And then he hadn't really been back in the game for 2 years. Going up against Joe Smith Jr., who got the WBC International Light Heavyweight title with a shocking TKO victory over Andre Samfara over in Chicago, Illinois, in June. So you had this fight here with Bernard Hopkins and Joe Smith. You know, for the first, you know, two or three rounds, it looked like Joe Smith Jr. had, like, the upper hand. And then Bernard Hopkins started to find his range and started to find that right hand, his patented right hand, counter and, you know, look to get that right hand in. And he was starting to connect pretty well with that right hand. And, you know, going into, you know, the second half of that fight, looked like Bernard Hopkins was trying to, you know, get the momentum there. And it went up into round eight. And then in round eight, Bernard Hopkins was, you know, moving around, and he got to one corner, and he was on the ropes against Joe Smith Jr., and looked like he was ducking, you know, a few punches here and there, and then it was crouching on the ropes, and he got caught with a couple of punches, and then while he was leaning back. He sat down between the second and third ropes and got caught with another punch there that hit his arm and hit him, and then he ended up going outside of the ring. And by that happening, it ended up that he was counted out of the ring, and it records as a KO victory for Joe Smith Jr. So Joe Smith ends up retaining the WBC International Light Heavyweight title, and Bernard Hopkins ends his career with the loss there at 55-8-2. With that being the lone KO loss in his career. I mean, to me, I mean, for that to be a KO loss, it's kind of like, you know, semi-sketchy to me, but, you know, I'll reserve my comments here in a little bit. World Rank, what you think overall for the card that happened on the forum and was televised by HBO?
I mean, the card, from what I, you know, my initial reaction to the card before the fights happened was, you know, they're trying to get a get Hopkins, you know, a send off win. You know, it's a showcase for Diaz, a showcase for Usyk. So, I mean, I didn't watch the fights live. I saw them later on. So the opponents, I mean, they were decent opponents. They were there what they, you know, what they supposed to do, for the exception of Joe Smith, who stepped up to the plate. In this fight with Fafar, I mean, there wasn't a lot in there that it would tell you, you know, how he would fare against Hopkins. I mean, everybody was thinking, including myself, that Hopkins would probably win unanimous decision. But Joe Smith, you know, he's making a name for himself in the light heavyweight division. If HBO going forward wants to continue with boxing, I would assume that they would think it's a good thing that Joe Smith won, because now they have an opponent for either Ward or Kovalev, and you know, so HBO can, you know, if they want, again, if they're still staying in the business, now they have an opponent for one of those two in case you know, the rematch doesn't happen. In terms of the actual fight, I mean, I've watched the knockout several times. I don't see any dispute in it. I think Joe Smith clearly landed hard punches. I didn't see any push. I didn't see anything that states it was questionable. I mean, Hopkins got out the ring. The ref gave him 20 seconds to get up and get back into the ring, but he was stopped by the doctors or whatever, and, you know, they didn't think he was well enough to go off. I don't see anything questionable about it. The punches landed clear. I didn't see a push. Maybe the doctor should not have stepped in and gave Hopkins an opportunity to see if he was going to make it, but he looked like he was out on his feet. So I didn't see any problem with the fight. It was surprising to see Hopkins like that, to go out on his last fight and to see him never been knocked out, and, you know, the quotes of never being knocked out by a white guy and everything that comes with it, even after the fight. Saying that he was pushed and, you know, not being able to accept the loss. I mean, the actual fight was pretty decent from what I saw. You know, the result maybe not to everyone's liking, but, you know, to me it was a clean result.
Yeah. I mean, I kind of like seen it as a, like I was saying, a typical Bernard, you know, Hopkins fight. You know, him kind of like starting slow early, and then, you know, after that, you know, kind of, you know, having the feel of what, you know, having a feel of what Joe Smith Jr. was doing, and he was connecting more with that right hand, and then, you know, starting in that sixth, seventh round, he was doing more combinations, those two or three punch combinations that, you know, was his basic MO. And, you know, while he was able to get those, that success in, to me, it kind of like showed that he showed, you know, that he was out of the ring for 2 years. And what I mean by that is that there were a couple of times where he was getting caught where if it was a Hopkins of, you know, 2013 or 2012 or 2011, even 2011, you wouldn't see him get caught by those type of punches. But here against Joe Smith Jr., he was basically having that happen to him. So he was getting tagged a little bit more than he's, you know, usually doing. But, you know, while thinking about this fight, you know, over the course of the day, I was saying that, I mean, to me, you know, while Joe Smith Jr. does get this win, I'm kind of like seeing that a lot of people aren't necessarily impressed with it because, for me, I thought Joe Smith Jr. would be a type of guy that would, you know, blitz Bernard Hopkins early on in the fight, not, you know, give him much of a, you know, not give him much of a chance. But the fight was actually closer, you know, than it should have been. And, you know, up to that point, Bernard Hopkins had, you know, led on one judge's scorecard and I think was one round down on another judge's scorecard. Continuing here, got area code 205. What's going on with you?
Hey, what's going on, James? It's Mike Grady. How you doing?
Doing good here. Mike Grady, just going over the fight card that happened at the Forum in Inglewood, California. Just ending here with that main event between Bernard Hopkins and Joe Smith Jr. So what was your thoughts about that fight?
I definitely think Bernard Hopkins looked old. And the reason why I say he looked old is because his base, like he had the legs of a 52-year-older. In that when he was moving, he never in any exchange, like he did it a couple times where he didn't really think about it, but for the most part he did those little choppy steps like the choppy,
yes.
I gotta keep my feet under me type steps, but he never like had like a strong, and not saying he does this, but has a strong wide base. Like he never put too much like weight on his feet. Like he was like light footed, you know, like he never like put a lot of weight on his feet. And, like,
right.
I think that ultimately caused him to get, like, knocked out of the ring because when he was on the ropes, don't get me wrong, I understand, like, you use the ropes and for the most part, you're using the ropes as another, you know, like you're sitting on the ropes and all you do is turn. I get that. But if you look at it, he was kind of cradling on the ropes and his feet wasn't even under him. And he wasn't even hurt per se. Like, he was hurt. And then he got caught with a good shot, but he just didn't have his feet under him. And it was like the same thing that happened earlier in the round where, like, you know, the choppy feet, his feet was not under him. And so when he finally did get caught with the uppercut, you know, his body went because his feet was not under. He didn't have, like, he wasn't on the ropes. Like, let's say if you look at a Floyd Mayweather's being on the ropes where Floyd has a good base, but he's still leaning on the ropes. Like, he could move and also transition, like, Bernard Hopkins, when he didn't have his base under him, like he had old man legs, and so I don't think I don't think it was as wide as Letterman had it because you know we all know his train of thinking. The lighter the person, the better they are. Mostly that's what it appears to be with him. But I don't think it was that close where they was like Bernard Hopkins up by one. Because I still think that, you know, like, the fight was definitely turning. Bernard Hopkins maybe won a couple rounds, in my opinion. And then, you know, you could see that Smith was waning. You know, you could see that. But it wasn't no drastic decline, though. It was, like, a gradual. You knew Bernard Hopkins would start coming on and probably get even more cleaner punches on Smith. But at the same time, Smith was the aggressor. And so I call it effective aggression because – you know, let's say you take that style of a Floyd Mayweather, of a Bernard Hopkins, but there were rounds where Bernard Hopkins clearly won. But even when he, like when Smith was throwing punches and he was like being the aggressor, I don't think Bernard Hopkins like made him pay for it. And it was a result of his leg not being under him. He didn't make him pay as much. Mm-hmm. Like the times where he did hit him clean, it was like punches where Smith wasn't really set or wasn't expecting the punch. Like he didn't, like, make him miss and pay like he normally does. And so
right.
I think he was old. I think he was old.
Yeah, I mean, it was kind of like a different type of you know, fight there with the Bernard Hopkins fight, especially, you know, early on in those first six rounds. You know, it's like you said, he didn't necessarily make him pay as often as he usually does. I mean, this wasn't a, you know, Bernard Hopkins that was a, you know, Bernard Hopkins that, you know, we saw a couple of years ago, you know, against the likes of a Baby Shumanoff or, you know, when he was going up against Tavoris Cloud or John Pascal or, you know, who would it be, like a Kelly Tablet. Because to me, when I was looking at this fight, I was thinking that this was almost like a similar fight to, like, Kelly Pavlik, where you would get a guy, because to me, Joe Smith is fairly like a Kelly Pavlik in that he's flat-footed. You can see when he's coming. You can see that he doesn't, you know, open himself up to, you know, set things up for himself, and that he doesn't fake with a jab to set up his right hand or anything like that. But he just comes in with a basic 1-2 and then sees if he could catch you with that 1-2. But here it was kind of like a different, you know, different atmosphere. Like you were saying there, Mike Brady, when you see that it was a 51- to 52-year-old man in the ring because he couldn't move in and out of it like he usually does. So he was getting tagged, you know, he was getting tagged more than he's used to in a fight like this. So, you know, while Joe Smith did have like a fairly low connect percentage, it was still to me kind of a higher overall percentage than Bernard Hopkins' opponents usually get to. Right.
And they were between the two, though.
Those were like big shots, you saying?
Yeah, they were like nice clean punches. They were like, yeah, bigger shots. Yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah, that was like a major difference there, you know, in between, you know, this fight and, you know, other fights that Bernard Hopkins are involved in. You want to add something to that, World Rank?
Yeah, so I'm just re-looking at the video, and I agree. He was not necessarily hurt from the punches once he left out. Again, I think it may have been one of those things where you're in the middle ground as if you're the commission or the people outside the ring. Where if you fall through the ring, I'm not sure that they knew or was conscious of it, or they were so surprised that he fell out the ring. They were not conscious of that 20 count rule. So they immediately went out and looked for him, which was, in terms of Hopkins getting back in the ring, maybe a mistake. I don't know how they would have. I don't know how you cannot handle that wrong. I think in any situation that probably would have been handled wrong if you fall out the ring like that, and then, you know, everybody's so close to the ring, and I'm not sure they thought to give him the 20 seconds to see if he give himself time to get back in the ring. They just got on him quickly because of the fall, and I'm not saying that, you know, the result would have changed or whatever, but I think it would have cleared things up. So now, you know, there's speculation or doubt, you know, that was did he fall out the ring because of the knockout? I don't think he was again knocked out. I would consider it as if someone got knocked down and got up and was maybe injured or something, and the ref was just pulled the fight off based on that, as opposed to a clear knockout.
Like, did you hear my commentary on, like, he didn't have his base under him and that was why he fell? Like, that, I agree. It's like he got knocked down and then, you know, it was like, he fell on his head, too. Like, he was saying that he didn't feel his foot. The reason why you didn't feel your foot, because you fell on your neck, you fell on your head. That's why you didn't feel your foot. It wasn't because your foot going down. It was because, you know, you damn near got concussed and probably did get concussed, you know, like he fell right on his head, on his neck and stuff. I'm surprised he didn't, like he said, he didn't get knocked out. I mean, he was kind of delirious saying that the guy pushed him, but I can see how he probably felt that it was a push, but yeah, he fell on his head, so that was kind of, it was interesting.
I mean, when Smith landed the punches, Hopkins' eyes was closed, so I don't know if how could he tell that that was a push. I mean, I understand, like you said, I understand why he might think it was a push, but his eyes wasn't open to see if he was pushed or if he wasn't. And, you know, his balance and the punch, I think both of them played equal role in him going to the rope.
Yeah, because, I mean, he was, like, leaning back, and when he leaned back, he didn't, you know, think that, you know, he didn't think that, you know, he would go through the ropes like that. One thing that I kind of, you know, didn't notice, I probably have to look at, you know, the fight again in the particular ring. I'm not sure if, you know, those, you know, ring ropes were kind of like the same thing that, you know, that you would see in other arenas or how they set things up in other arenas, because that kind of like was weird to me how, you know, he was able to, like, sit back and then it would be that much of a gap in between those two ropes where he would actually fall through like that, you know. But that's something that I'll have to, you know, look into later on. And, yeah, the other thing was, like, him falling back, he was, like, one of the things that I was, like, that I was going back and forth on in a few, you know, boxing avenues was that, you know, people were saying that Bernard Hopkins was out on his feet when he went out of the ring, and then he came to once he fell out of the ring. And I'm like, that can't be the case. If you were basically out on your feet and then you get knocked out of the ring, you would still be laying on the ground outside the ring if you were out on your feet. So you can't just be out of your feet, then you hit the ground and hit your head, and then all of a sudden you've woken up like that. I just can't see that, where he was able to actually get up as fast as he was and then be able to try to come to in order to get back into the ring if he was out on his feet.
You make a good point on that, but what I will say, I'm looking at it right now. You know when a fighter gets hit and they let their guard down, like they lose their consciousness or whatever that is for that split second where after they get hit, they let their hand down, similar to what Pavlik did with the Taylor. I see that in Hopkins at that time, though. I see where Smith hits him, and then he lets his hands go, and he looks like he's out of it, and then gets hit again, and that's when he goes through the ropes. I do see that give in his, I guess, his mental state where he does – he lets his hands go, and it seems like he's out of it for that second.
I'm not sure, because to me, I didn't see, like, any punch that was so clear on Hopkins that it would make him be out on his feet. You see what I'm saying? You, like, you know how sometimes you can see, like, a big punch coming to an opponent, where you know that he's going to be basically on his feet. Like, for example, I think it was last weekend where, let me see, I think it was at super lightweight. Yeah, super lightweight. You had Edward Troyanovsky going up against Julius Ndongo. And, you know, Julius Ndongo was able to get Troyanovsky with the right hand, I think it was. And before the punch, you can see Troyanovsky, like, close his eyes, and then it, like, hits him square in the face, and then he gets, like, laid out. So at least there, you kind of, like, knew that the fighter was out before he even hit the ground. And here, I didn't necessarily see Bernard Hopkins, like, be knocked out before, you know, he hits the part where he goes outside the ring. It's probably like a, you know, a difference of opinion right there, though. You know what I'm saying?
No, it's clearly on there. I'm not saying that he was out on his feet, but it looked, I see the give in his hand, and I see him that daze. It's not even a look because his eyes are closed, like he's out. But he somehow, I don't know if he's out and there's a punch that landed, but it's clearly in the video. It clearly shows that he drops his hand and he's dazed right there, like he's hurt. It's clear on there. There's no dispute. Now, on your comment, there could be dispute in terms of could you do that and then come right back. And I can understand that. But the video shows that his hands He lowers his hands like he's out, and then he takes another punch, and he goes through the ropes, eyes closed, like he's gone.
So I want to weigh in on this as well, too. I get what you're saying, World Rank. He got hit, and in that moment when he got hit, he, of course, was buzzed, dazed, whatever you want to call it. He got rocked. And so the fact that the guy was already, like, not kind of light on his feet, he was leaning on the rope. This is to your point, James. He was leaning on the rope, and so his shoulder was, for the most part, while he was cradling on the rope, his shoulder was, for the most part, all the surface area that had him holding on the rope. And so pretty much his weight was going down, so all the rope did was just go upward. I mean, I know I'm chopping this up on my description, but all that was holding him up was his shoulder. And so when all his weight was pushing down, the rope pretty much ricocheted up, and that's how he went through the rope. I could be wrong, but that's what I feel like I saw. And then, you know, in that moment, the second before that, he got hit, and then he was sort of hurt because the dude landed a clean punch at him. Was he out on his feet? I don't think so. I think he was hurt. Like, it was like one of those knocks. I mean, he was going to get knocked down probably, but, you know, probably not to the point to where he would quit the fight, because as you saw, when he hit the ground on his head, that's when he was like, oh, shit, you know, like, ooh. And then he was kind of like, I felt like he was out at that point, but then he came back real fast. And then, you know, then he felt them tinglings in his leg because he hit his head. So, yeah, it was just a bad situation all around.
Hey, James.
Yeah.
Did you see the video that I sent you on Twitter early in the day?
I think you posted it. You know what I'm saying? But like, there was like that last punch that you know Joe Smith had, right? Like, it looked like he threw a left, and then it hit Hopkins' arm, but the left continued through Hopkins' arm, and then it still hit like Hopkins' face before he went outside the ring.
Yeah, he looked like he was out at that point, though.
Maybe. But my thing is that if he was basically out at that point, you know, I think the ref would have stepped in. Especially, you know, given the fact that, you know, Bernard Hopkins was 51, you know, 1 month away from being 52. You know, 2 years removed from his last professional fight against Sergey Kovalev. So I think the ref could have like stepped in and seen something happen there. But you know, by the time anything happened there, he fell out the ropes, and then it was pretty much a state of shock. You know, all across the board. It's like you were saying, World Rank. Nobody in that immediate vicinity of the ring kind of expected something like that to happen to anybody. So it's like, okay, someone's out of the ring, now what happens? You know what I mean? So it's like the boxing commission, or, you know, the referees or the judges or anything like that, or, you know, the cornermen, you know, that kind of, you know, was reared there in that sense. Another thing real quick that I thought about going into the fight, Bernard Hopkins, you know, was going in there training, and his, you know, number one trainer there was John David Jackson instead of Nassim Richardson. And we know that, you know, John David Jackson was the main trainer for Sergey Kovalev, and Nassim Richardson was like the longtime trainer for Bernard Hopkins. So I thought that was kind of weird there, and I never really, you know, got the 411 as to why Hopkins chose John David Jackson instead of Nassim Richardson.
I could see Nassim Richardson saying that, I don't think you should fight this last fight if he saw that he had enough drop-off, because I equate this Bernard Hopkins to what happened to Roy Jones Jr. Roy Jones Jr. became so susceptible to regular fighters when his legs went. And not saying that, you know, Bernard Hopkins was a a Regan Diaw or, no, or nothing like that. But, you know, his legs was a part of his arsenal to where he could move, slip, punch, and also throw back at you. And so, you know, just imagine Roy Jones Jr. after his legs went. This is the exact same thing that happened. And luckily, it happened so later in Bernard Hopkins' career. But I could see Basim Richardson being like, I don't think you should go out there. And then, you know, choosing pretty much to just fit it because he knew what we already knew, that Hopkins' legs were gone.
True, true. All right, before I, like, get into this next segment, for those listening in on Blog Talk Radio through Go Long Media, if you want to speak in on the sport of boxing, call in at 347-237-5539. That's 347-237-5539. Press the 1 key to get on cue, and you'll be able to talk live on the show. Like we were talking about here with Joe Smith Jr. and his potential, the potential opponents that he may have. I think there was one here where I posted the video for that particular fight that happened on Friday night where you have Vyacheslav Shabransky going up against Sullivan Barrera. And in that one, Sullivan Barrera ended up winning the fight by knockout victory. He scored like a couple of knockdowns before that and also suffered a knockdown in the process. But Sullivan Barrera, of course, is, you know, a guy that was there up against Andre SOG Ward back in 2016. On March 26, 2016, as part of that, you know, three-fight process before Ward fought Sergey Kovalev. So, Barrera, you know, after severing his first loss of his career, was able to go up against Shabransky for the for a United States light heavyweight title. And so he was able to get that that KO win to kind of, like, move up into – in the ranks there in the WBC. Shabransky up to that point was the number five ranked guy at light heavyweight, you know, while Barrera was there at number 12. So he moves up in the ranks. They have Joe Smith Jr. There at number two. Elider Alvarez is the number one guy for Adonis Stevenson. I think that Alvarez and Stevenson are pretty much in line to fight each other here in 2017. So it kind of like leaves Joe Smith Jr., you know, without an opponent, and Sullivan Barrera might be a good little matchup for Joe Smith Jr. to see if he's still, you know, up there as a serious guy within the light heavyweight division. So what do y'all think about that real quick?
I definitely think Smith is he won't be Kovalev, he won't be Ward. Sullivan Barrera, will he beat him? I think offensively Sullivan Barrera is straight, but I mean he got touched a few times too though, so I would have to go back and watch him. And then I don't know, it's hard to judge people off of Andre Ward because Andre Ward kind of takes people's weapons away, sort of. I'm deferring to you guys. I don't know who would win because they both are on the sort of same level.
All right. World Ring, you got something real quick before I head on to the next caller?
Yeah, I agree that they're basically the same level. Smith is in a better position, though, because, you know, he's beat two guys that he didn't suppose to beat. And, you know, one of them was on HBO against a legend. So, like I said earlier, I think he's a good B-side to Kovalev or Ward. Not that he would win, but he's a qualified opponent for those guys if they don't fight each other. I think HBO's happy that Joe Smith won because now they have an opponent for either one of those guys if those two don't rematch.
Right, gotcha. All right, now I'm bringing area code 813. What's going on here with you? 813, what up?
Hey, what's up? What's up? What's up, fellas? This is Terrell Hall from Tampa checking in.
All right, there, Terrell. Just went through the card there in the forum in Inglewood, you know, with Joe Smith Jr. Getting that KO win over Bernard Hopkins. So, what's your two cents on it?
Well, and just going back a little bit, I'm sure you guys have already talked about the meters, but in regards to Smith himself, I remember that you mentioned last week that he actually KO'd what's his name, Funfara, who's always been a tough,
yes,
a tough cagey guy, who was the same guy that went up to Canada a couple years ago and gave Adonis Stevenson a hell of a fight, right?
Yeah.
All right. So really, just all, from that point, from what I saw, Smith, that dude can punch. He can punch. And I'm not sure how long he's been a pro, his background and stuff like that. But if somebody can get with him and refine him, he could have some things to say in the division going forward. But it was one thing that's pretty ironic. Nazim Richardson, Hopkins' long-time corner man, basically made the statement,
yep,
that, well, hope Hopkins doesn't end up on his ass. And what's funny, that's exactly what happened emphatically, you know. And I, you know, and I'm not laughing about it, but I mean, I don't want to see Hopkins fall like that. You know what I'm saying? But it's so funny that someone that you've been with for so long made a forecasting statement, and it came out to be true. And it, not just that, neither side will reveal on why Richardson was not in Hopkins' corner. I mean, at the same time, it's like, did it really matter that much? Well, of course it matters. It does matter to a degree. How much I really can't measure at this point. I mean, but how many times have we seen,
mm-hmm,
top fighters switch from coach to coach or whatever, trainer to trainer, and sometimes has an effect,
yeah,
sometimes it don't. One recent example, when Bradley switched to Taylor Atlas, did we really see a change? Because at that point, Bradley is who he already is. I mean, there may be some things that Atlas can possibly implement here and there, but
yeah,
nevertheless, your trainer does matter. So, like I said, for Hopkins, one, he hadn't fought in some time now, and then you change your routine, have a different trainer. Did it have an effect? It possibly did. You never know. I mean, at this point, because we don't know why he wasn't there, you probably won't ever find out the real reason why he was not there. But it was Smith can punch. He can punch. And like I said in the chat group, that Hopkins is getting dementia. That's pretty funny. Because that post-interview, I mean, he was gracious in it in some points, but at the same time, his main contention was like, oh, I was pushed out of the ring. No, you were punched out of the ring, clearly. You know, so, but moving forward.
Yeah. All right, here, we got about 12 minutes left on the show here, and pretty much going to go over a couple of things that happened within the sport of boxing. I'm sure this little segment here will give a little smile to one of the callers here on the show, as I'm going to go over something that happened earlier on Saturday, as there was supposed to be a heavyweight fight for the number one contendership of the WBC heavyweight title. This fight was supposed to be against Alexander Povetkin and Bermond Stiverne. Now, weeks ago, we kind of found out that Bermond Stiverne got caught with a substance, and he ended up going through with the fight anyway because they were saying that Stiverne inadvertently took this sports drink that had an advanced substance in it. So the WBC kind of like gave him the benefit of the doubt. Now, coming up to Friday, pretty much the day before the fight and a little bit after the weigh-in and everything like that, we come to find out that Alexander Povetkin got caught with a sample of the same thing that Terrell's boy Lucien Boutte had before his fight for that super middleweight title. So with that being known, Severn said, you know what, man, I'm out this bitch. And he backed out of the fight. The WBC didn't sanction it. What's his name? Povetkin's promoter went on ahead and carried over with the card. And they found a replacement fighter for Ramon Stavern. And so that fighter ended up, you know, being Johan Duopar, of course, and we know about Johan Duopar from his notable fight against a certain fighter that has a heavyweight title. And he ended up stepping up, getting this particular fight. He was supposed to actually fight somebody else. I think it was Carlos Takam, in 2017, but it looked like that fight kind of fell through. So looked like Duopar was out there sitting on the bench waiting for, I guess, a fight. So he looked like he was the replacement for Ramon Stavern. And, of course, I've posted this link here that, you know, Alexander Povetkin ended up getting up with a, you know, good little two shots right in the chin on Duopar and laid Duopar out. So Alexander Povetkin does get the KO win. However, it's it may be all for naught because he got caught with another banned substance. So we might not see him as part of the WBC rankings anymore, even though, you know, WBC is known to kind of give the benefit of a doubt to a lot of fighters that have taken illegal substances. Otherwise, we wouldn't have had that Orlando Salido Francisco Vargas fight. So the first person I want to hear from is the guy that's probably the most happy that this dude would tell. All right, Mike Grady, what you got?
So I'm going to correct one thing you said. Whether he got caught or not, so if he wasn't taking steroids way back when he could have fought Deontay Wilder, he would have got knocked out by Deontay Wilder, probably not in a similar fashion that Vitaly or whatever Klitschko fought him, whichever one of them fought him, knocked him out. But he still would have got knocked out nevertheless. With
that's
that being
speculation.
Said, based on speculation, based on him being a taller fighter who gets jabbed very much and then is very susceptible to getting hit by a strong right hand. So let's think about it. When Manny Pacquiao, I'm going to repeat exactly what I said from Facebook. When Manny Pacquiao was taking vitamin supplements, he had a very strong knockout streak. And once he started getting tested, once he wasn't taking that Manny Pacquiao, all the knockouts went away. So let's, you know, and so let's say guys who got hit by stronger punches, supposedly than Manny Pacquiao, who got hit by real solid guys, they didn't get knocked out by those solid guys. But then when Manny Pacquiao was in the ring with him, they got knocked out by him. So let's go back to Duopas, where he getting hit by somebody who it took them 10, 11 rounds to knock him out. He getting hit by the kitchen sink, everything, and this guy still taking it. If you got that Manny Pacquiao going through your veins, it ain't much you can do. It ain't much you can do to you know, your chin ain't meant to be standing up to Manny Pacquiao, you know, to that Manny Pacquiao. And I mean, the guy got caught. I mean, and the dude went along with the fight, and so what you expect? I will say what I feel like happened was, because I saw the knockout that you posted, James. So he got hit with one punch, right? And then, like, I'm going to paraphrase what Warring said, but not exactly mean what exactly he said. So let's say you get hit by a punch, and then somebody, when you get hit by that punch, you sort of get stunned a little bit. You get, like, the deer in the headlights sort of reaction. So you get hit by a punch, and then you get a deer in the headlights, and your arms sort of go down. So it was a moment where Duopas got hit, and then he had the deer in the headlights syndrome, and his hands kind of went down. So he was just frozen for 1 second. And it just so happened that's when the guy with that Manny Pacquiao running through his veins hit him with a straight punch, and that's how he got knocked out. But for the most part, I would imagine he was taking the punches pretty clean, other than him, you know, backing out. But, I mean, if he wasn't taking the steroids, he'll get beat like how the Klitschko beat him, and, you know, Deontay Wilder would still win that fight. But I'm going to pass it to the next person.
All right, who else got something on it?
Yo.
Yeah,
I can go. I don't know where all this Wilder love is coming from. I didn't get a chance to talk about the Joshua fight last week, but these opponents, and I get the Manny Pacquiao syndrome, but you know Antonio Tarver had it. He wasn't knocking guys out when he was on it. I mean, there's some fighters who take steroids who still wasn't power punchers once they took it. So I don't want to give Povetkin too much credit, but I'm not going to just say that he knocked this guy out because of the steroids. Because there's other guys other than Manny Pacquiao who get caught for this stuff who ain't punching harder than they were when they took it. So I don't want to give him too much credit or not take enough credit from him because of him testing positive for whatever he tests positive for.
Can I ask you a question?
Yes.
If Pauly Malignaggi took steroids, do you think he would be knocking people out?
No. Antonio Tarver took it, and he wasn't knocking nobody out in his career. He still had man boobs and had steroids. So it just depends on what they're taking, and all steroids aren't equal. You know what I'm saying? So, you know,
yeah,
there's
I
certain
got- –
yeah, so – I don't know what Povetkin was taking, but I think that result was going to happen if he was on or if he was off. I think, you know, again, I think we given or Wilder is just not as good as some people think he is. If these guys are – if Joshua's getting the guy out in one round or two rounds and it takes Wilder 8-9 rounds and he's struggling, dual hop he was struggling with, Povetkin got him out in one round – in two punches, really. Not even a full round, two punches. Something. I mean, again, Povetkin might have been on something. He was on something, clearly. But I think Wilder just isn't that guy that everybody thinks he is. That's what I take out of this fight. And Duhabis, well, I don't know what he was doing to – I want to say this clear. Mexico and Russia run boxing, clearly, because this is full proof that Russia runs boxing. If you have Romain Stavern who gets caught with something, and as an opponent, you obviously feel like he's dirty, but I'm dirty too, so we might as well go on with the fight. And the WBC still sanctioned, knowing both of them had previous pads, this was a clear setup for Rubinsky and his team to get Povetkin that title, and the WBC held their hands the entire way until they couldn't do it any longer. And the fact that Duhapis was already there, signed up as a backup to this fight, tell you what the shady business was going on.
Yeah, I mean, that's what I was saying in reference to the WBC. I mean, for some reason, it's kind of weird because, like, there's things that I was seeing about the WBC and what they're trying to do in, like, this so-called clean boxing program or whatever it is. But, however, if they have this so-called clean boxing program, then how are they able to let fights like these happen? How are they able to Francisco Vargas, Orlando Salido fight happen with Vargas, you know, able to continue to fight, you know, while having a banned substance within his system and be able to defend his title, you know, and then still turn around to have this fight here that was supposed to be for the number one contendership of the WBC heavyweight belt. So it's kind of like a contradictory thing here with the World Boxing Council. If they're trying to be a clean program, but yet you're letting these fights go through because you know how much money is involved with it, then, I mean, that shows a lot about the WBC and Suleiman, Junior Suleiman, that is, because, you know, the original Suleiman passed, what was it, a couple years ago.
Well, I don't know about you guys, but I'm about to go all Stephen A. Smith on Povetkin. I mean, this is a mockery. This is a shame. This is so many bad words. Now, one of my first things after you guys broke the news to me that Povetkin tested positive yet again within the year. Now, first of all, this dude should be suspended. Period. This dude should be suspended for 2 to 3 years or whatever that. At whatever that minimum is for that. Now, another point, too, a lot of people were comparing Povetkin's win over Duhapis with Wilder's win. Now, first of all, Duhapis was not in shape for this fight. He was a backup plan. He probably didn't have a training camp. They probably had him in place in the event of a backup plan. And, hell, they probably knew that Povetkin was going to test positive, you know? So he deserves zero credit for getting the win over Duhapis, who was not in shape as far as having a full training camp, training for Povetkin and training for that fight. Right? So zero credit.
That's a good point.
Not only that, but the fact that he tested positive yet again. And this is mockery. And, you know, pardon me, I wish that Severn would have went on with the fight because we hadn't seen him fight. We want to see what he has still at this point. But I totally understand his reason for backing out of the fight. Like you said, the WC withdrew their certification for the fight. So it's kind of like, what are you fighting for?
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's like, why even take that risk? I guess that his money is okay enough the way he had to go forward to fight. I hope he got some kind of money out of this fight, even though he withdrew or whatever. I'm not sure, but obviously he made this decision for himself, which is even shameful because he just tested positive himself. Even though that was excused and everything, but for a guy to test positive twice in a year, and it is a mockery. And for Povetkin, this incriminates him even further in regards to Deontay Wilder's suit against him for testing positive on their fight. You know, but Povetkin deserves no credit. He should be suspended. I don't knock Duhapis at all. I'm sure he wasn't in shape for this fight. And one thing on World Rank, I mean, one thing I said about Wilder, I want Wilder to be everything that people want him to be. I hope that he can achieve that. I really, because that would be great for to have a great American heavyweight champion. Now we already know he doesn't punch well. There's a lot of stuff that Wilder does not do well. We know that, you know. But hopefully, I mean, I'll say this, with the heavyweight pitcher, if he can change the stuff up, this dude can be right there in position for the unified titles that maybe by the end of next year, because there's been mention of him fighting Parker, and I think that's a fight that he can win because there's nothing scary about Parker other than this movement that concerns me with a Wilder fight, you know. But just saying that once again, this thing with this past weekend is ridiculous, and I hope that Povetkin just gets suspended. It's ridiculous, man.
So the thing about Wilder
is that
his athleticism is so great compared to all of these other slugs that's in the heavyweight division that it don't even matter that he got all these flaws. Like his athleticism puts him head over shoulders over like 90-85% of these guys. Joshua, Povetkin, Tyson Fury, even what's the name who getting old? Klitschko who getting old. I personally think Wilder, with all his flaws, will beat all these guys off of his athleticism. And yeah, I mean, in my opinion, what he was doing years ago to what he's doing now, he's gotten better. Yes, he gets in front of the Alabama crowd. He starts hearing the yells and stuff, and then he wants to do that Mexican style and just like hit people and stuff. But then when he raises his level of competition, as you've seen with Severn, that he fights more control, and then he beats people how he should beat them, because he fought more control with Severn. I mean, he just fought like squares where he could pretty much loaf. With Areola, he loafed. And he broke his arm. That's got to say something about somebody. They break their dang – I mean, okay, he punched wrong. But But let's say you break your knuckle or whatever you broke, and then you broke a shoulder or something too, elbow, I don't know, whatever. He broke his arm, and he's still hitting the guy with the same arm. Man, that's a temper. That's all I know.
I just know the difference between these other guys and Wilder is Wilder's struggling with these guys. These other guys are getting these guys out of here like they supposed to. They dispatching them. Wilder struggles with these guys. When you're this big of a favorite in all these fights and you're struggling with every single guy, there's a problem there. There's a problem clearly there. He has the athletic talent. Yes, he does. He has everything that Joshua has. Why isn't he a star? Because he's struggling with these guys. We're looking for the next Mike Tyson, and this guy is struggling with these guys. This guy is our American hope, but nobody's giving him hope because they've seen him and he's struggling with these guys. I'm not saying he can't change. I'm not even saying he can't beat these guys. I'm just saying right now these guys are looking much better because they're dispatching these guys easily.
Well, so I think what you call struggling is a subjective view, because where you may say struggling, he knocked out everybody except for one person. So if he's struggling, just because Floyd Mayweather go 12 rounds don't mean he's struggling. Just because Deontay Wilder don't press these guys as earlier.
He's losing rounds. These guys aren't losing rounds to these guys. He's losing rounds to these guys.
I would question that.
That's
who he lost rounds
to. You can't.
Who did he lose
rounds to? Necessarily compare. Well, I would say to Spoker for one, but you can't compare somebody like Floyd Mayweather that where you know that he's actually winning the rounds compared to Deontay Wilder where he's losing rounds against these guys.
Yeah,
and
he's losing rounds
against the thing about it is with Deontay Wilder is that he's supposed to be like blowing away these guys, like World Rank said, away these guys. Now, there have been two fighters that Deontay Wilder and Anthony Joshua fought pretty much so far in their careers. And pretty much in both of those cases, Anthony Joshua has been able to execute and, dispatch of his opponent quicker than what Wilder did or, in more impressive fashion than what Wilder did. And
because the quicker you knock somebody out,
With Anthony Joshua, you're talking about an Anthony Joshua that hasn't really had 20 fights under his belt yet, So that's why it's seeming like more people are more impressed with what, Anthony Joshua is doing here so far in his career in comparison to what Deontay Wilder is doing. And so that's why a lot more interest is put into Anthony Joshua in comparison to Deontay Wilder. Because right now, like I was saying last week, Anthony Joshua has that fight against Vladimir Klitschko. Deontay Wilder does not.
I would ask you two questions. What do you think is the reason why a person like Anthony Joshua would turn down Wilder's request to fight him? And or what do you think it is about Deontay Wilder that a Klitschko would also not be interested as quickly to fight him as well either? And what does I got three questions.
Ask that third question.
And the third question is, what does knocking somebody out in round three versus round six mean? What does that actually mean?
Okay. Now, to go into your first two questions, it's very easy. Money. Now, here's the thing.
What competitive advantage? Okay, money, we get that. All right, but what competitive advantage would make them not want to fight him? Because that's what I think.
There would be more notoriety, and you would be higher up in the ranks by fighting Anthony Joshua right now than for fighting Deontay Wilder. It would be. And the thing about it is that you have somebody that shot up to being 15 fights within his career, than winning a belt against a guy that won a vacant belt in the IBF heavyweight title belt. And all of a sudden, he's one of the top one or two fighters in the heavyweight division already. Where in comparison, you have, like I said, the same guy that had a belt that basically got it from a vacant belt, you know, that had it because it was vacated, and he's already shot up to being the top one and two guys in the heavyweight division, just like that, you know. So there's like, when I see a lot of these boxing pundits rank Anthony Joshua this high, that fast, that says a lot about what Anthony Joshua is within the heavyweight division. And not only that, you see that not only with those boxing pundits and those that are, you know, writing the articles and everything like that, but you see it with other fighters as well. Not just with a Shannon Briggs, but also with the Tyson Fury or Vladimir Klitschko or any of these other heavyweight fighters that are out there. They know something about Anthony Joshua that says, hey, this is the next guy in the heavyweight division. And they're not seeing it with Deontay Wilder up to this point. That has to speak for something.
Why would he be the next guy in the heavyweight division if he is the guy in the heavyweight division? How can he be the next guy if he already is the guy in the division?
Who's the guy in the division?
Arguably Deontay Wilder.
Well, you,
I added that word for a reason.
Joshua can make that same case. I mean, Klitschko can make that same case since Fury retired. We got three guys. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Like, there could be a case for all of them saying that they're the best. But what sets Joshua apart right now, and again, I'm not saying Joshua would beat Wilder or lose to Wilder. I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is that he's being more impressive in his wins. And at this stage, when you're fighting world champions and you're not losing a round, like you fought for a belt, you took somebody's belt and you didn't lose a round. Then you defended against someone, against a similar opposition, I guess someone that you're trying to be compared to, and you dominate them, you didn't lose a round, a second of any round. But Wilder struggled with
round against that dude because the dude touched him real, real bad in a couple rounds. The dude beat him in the amateurs. He won the round because he touched him a lot.
No, I was saying once he won the title. Yeah,
oh, that was
Yeah, White touched him. White touched him. He definitely touched him. But now we're starting to see that White is a very good fighter.
And we saw that last week in the undercard of Joshua's fight, you know, against Derek Chisora, which was a very good fight.
Yeah, but these guys,
you know.
Yeah, but now Wilder's out. And Wilder even said it himself. He said, man, if I get the support from America that Joshua's getting in Europe, I'd be a star. And he agrees that he even sees Joshua as his really next competition. I mean, this guy is
fighting him, though. Joshua don't want to fight Wilder. Because the risk that Joshua sees in fighting Wilder is a lot greater than the risk that Wilder sees in fighting Joshua. Meaning that Joshua's more likely to fight Wilder.
That does not mean that Joshua is ducking Wilder by any sense. I don't see that in any sense there that Joshua would be ducking Wilder at this point, and he wasn't ducking him in the past. There's no point of doing that when he knows that he could get these, you know, big fights against, you know, who was up until 2015 the number one guy in the heavyweight division in Vladimir Klitschko. So it's like, well, yeah, I could fight, you know, Deontay Wilder. And, yeah, I'll be able to win this WBC belt if I beat him. But I could also fight Vladimir Klitschko, who was regarded as the number one guy in the heavyweight division up until, you know, losing against Fury. And it would be one of the biggest fights in the heavyweight division in, like, the past 5 or 10 years. Of course I'm going to take it. Of course I'm going to go for Klitschko in that instance.
I mean, I agree. Klitschko is greater than Wilder.
Well, one thing too,
Klitschko is greater than Wilder. I agree.
One thing to consider too, guys, is that remember that Joshua is a gold Olympic gold medalist winner. Now, You ask, what does that mean? Well, look at De La Hoya. Look what he did with his gold medal. He definitely got the right marketing behind him and things like that. So even though gold medal isn't always a guarantee you're going to be the best thing, but it's, he definitely it gives you a certain profile as a boxer, a certain notoriety that other people just don't have that didn't go that path, and they get that accomplishment. So really the main point of contention here is Joshua has achieved so much more in Wilder than pretty much half the time and half the fights. And really, it says that. Now, I don't think it's a knock on Wilder, because we know that he feasted on a lot of, I'm going to say, low-level competition in his first 10 to 15 fights. Yes, he did. But you know
29
what?
29 fights.
I'm not going to kill him for that. You know, that's the route he took. He has a belt now. So, move forward. I mean, kudos to Joshua. That he has that profile, that gold medal, they helped him, you know, they helped his marketing and things like that. And he had smart people behind him as well. But, like I said, I'm not going to kill Wilder because he has twice the amount of fights and maybe not as much profile. That's okay. He'll get it. He's on track. He's on track, definitely.
So I got a few rebuttals to what you said. Okay, Joshua won a gold medal, but if you ask certain people, the gold medal was given to him. He won. Don't get me wrong. He won. But same way Floyd Mayweather lost the Olympics. And the guy who beat Floyd Mayweather is like, I wish I didn't win the Olympics. Because they treat him as if he judged the score. Joshua has a gold medal. Deontay Wilder didn't box none in his life until he was in his upper 20s and still won a bronze medal. So that says a lot more than some guy with a Olympics when you was in your hometown, and then the judges was giving you rounds and fights where it could have went both ways, versus somebody who started boxing in their 20s and still won a bronze medal. To me, that's more impressive. I don't know, could be wrong, could be biased.
Yeah, I would say to you that's more impressive because. In reference to Anthony Joshua, he kind of like started his boxing career around that same time, and he was still able to get a gold medal. But before we like get too far into that, you know, we're in the overtime, and I wanted to get this thing in here for the announcements that are going on in reference to what's in store for next year. And basically in between Friday and Saturday, the people for Gennady Golovkin and Daniel Jacobs, they were able to get a deal done before the purse bid was going to be ordered on Monday. So we're going to have on March 18th at the Madison Square Garden, Gennady Golovkin, who's the unified middleweight champion against the WBA regular middleweight champion, Daniel Jacobs. Of course, he's the miracle man with a 32-1 record with 29 KOs. And you have Gennady Golovkin there at 36-0 with 33 KOs. So this to me is definitely a step up fight for Gennady Golovkin. I mean, of course, I haven't really been that much sold on Gennady Golovkin, especially with the performances or the fights that he's had here in 2016, you know, fighting Dominic Wade, who kind of was elevated to that number one contendership in the IBF, and going up against Kell Brook, who was supposed to be a guy that was too small for him up until April of 2016, but then all of a sudden that fight seemed like a fight that, you know, Golovkin and K2 couldn't pass up. So March 18th, Gennady Golovkin against Daniel Jacobs, and I said it last night and I'm going to say it right now, I'm picking Jacobs to win that fight. I'm going to have Terrell, could you open up first with the reaction of the announcement that deal was agreed to?
Yeah, definitely. First of all, I'm so glad that this fight is signed and it's on the calendar. And like I say, for a certain number of fights, let's hope and pray, cross your fingers, cross your toes, that nothing happens. There's no injury, no Keith Thurman accident, nothing like that. to what he's they can actually get their ass in the ring and fight. All right. So I'm not going to go into a whole lot about the fight because it's signed. So that's the first step. Now, the one thing I'm curious about the fight is what's the purse split, because I don't think that was announced. I haven't heard anything about that, because as we know, Jacobs was trying to bargain in position for more money and everything. So mm-hmm. I'm curious to know what that's going to be. But I definitely got Jacobs going to as well. Size-wise, he matches up well against Triple G. He's going to be right there with Power. It's going to be in New York, so he's going to have that home crowd behind him. So I don't need to go on a lot about the fight. I'm just glad that it's signed, and I just hope that nothing happens to either fighter so I can get that butt in the ring and fight.
Yeah. All right, next with Mike Grady.
I mean, I'm glad they're fighting. But if I had to say my honest opinion, which I am, I favor Golovkin. It's I think this is like a type of fight where I use Ruslan Provodnikov and Timothy Bradley. I'm gonna use that. So in the Ruslan Provodnikov and Timothy Bradley fight, it was a war of wheels, right? So was Provodnikov's wheel going to be greater than Timothy Bradley? And so at the end of the day, even though Timothy Bradley was sort of out on his feet, at the end of the fight, Timothy Bradley's wheel prevailed for the most part. In the span of 12 rounds and ending at the 12th round, his wheel prevailed. So if I apply that same logic to Jacobs and Golovkin, I just don't see Jacobs' wheel prevailing over Golovkin. I want him to win, but I just don't see it prevailing. I'm having a hard time seeing it prevail because I've seen his wheel get questioned. I ain't gonna say it was broken, but maybe it's not a point of his wheel. I think Golovkin has a greater power to break Jacobs' wheel than does Jacobs to break Golovkin's wheel. And I want him to win, but I just don't know.
All right, World Rank.
So we talked about on this show about what style, what type of fighter would beat Triple G. We said a long, rangy boxer with some power and that's kind of sturdy. Jacobs fits every criteria but sturdiness. The question will be, because everybody with Jacobs, they always go back to the Peraz fight and him getting knocked out. Some people think that was a fluke. That fight was a fluke. That knockout was a fluke. The more knockdown kind of got people to think that maybe Jacobs has a chin problem. That is the question in the fight. If Jacobs' chin can hold up, he has the offensive talent to beat Triple G. But the question is, can he stand the onslaught and can his chin take it? And that's the question that needs to be answered on that day.
Yeah. I mean, and it's funny how a lot of people, you know, immediately go to that P-Rock fight. Number one, that P-Rock fight was 6 years ago. And I'm like, you're going to try to bring up something that 6 years ago, but don't bring up the string of KO victories that Daniel Jacobs has had since that fight. It's kind of funny to me. And the other thing is that, you know, the type of competition, to me, in my opinion, I think the type of competition that Daniel Jacobs has had, especially recently, has been better than, you know, what Gennady Golovkin has had. I mean, to me, Peter Quillin is, you know, a better fighter at middleweight than anybody that Gennady Golovkin has faced. I don't give him as much credit to beating David Lemieux, because David Lemieux was kind of like a fringe fighter up to that point where he beat Hassan and Dom. So in order to kind of like get a real gauge of where Gennady Golovkin is, especially at this age where he's at 35 years old, is this particular fight here against Daniel Jacobs, where he is a taller fighter, he has the range, he has the arm reach, he has power in both hands. He just doesn't, you know, have to see if he can get into, you know, close quarters with a Gennady Golovkin. And my thing is that I would have to see how many skills Gennady Golovkin has at this stage of his career. If he's able to, you know, be mobile in the ring, or if he's going to be flat-footed against a guy like Daniel Jacobs. And if he's going to be flat-footed against Daniel Jacobs, then Jacobs can utilize a jab, utilize his reach, make Gennady Golovkin reset a lot of times to where he's not going to be as successful as he was against the likes of a Dominic Wade or a Kell Brook or a David Lemieux, or, you know, up to the point against Monroe. So this is, you know, one of the many fights that I'm looking forward to in 2017. You know, of course, you have Thurman against Garcia is another one. So I'm kind of like looking forward to that as well. of course, you have the thing there with Badu Jack against James Aguirre in January. And then February you have the rematch between Carl Frampton and Leo Santa Cruz. So the first 3 to 4 months in the year 2017 is going to be a very good one in the sport of boxing, giving us a lot of action. And I'll probably have a little article on that, plus reviewing the year in 2016 as well on the chonsports.com. So be on the lookout for that. Seeing here, going to close out the show, but this is going to most likely be the last show of 2016. So I'm going to see if I can get a little bit from, you know, each of my well-esteemed colleagues on their review of 2016. So I'm going to first start off with a world rank. What you got?
So 2016 for me, kind of a disappointment year. No real big standout fights. A lot of question in terms of where boxing is going on network TV. What will HBO do going forward? Showtime has picked up a little bit. PBC has slowed down a little or a lot. So just trying to head into 2017, you know, to see some good fights. You know, you got Thurman and Garcia on deck. You got a few other fights. So we're just hoping to put some new stars in American light and even in the world, and just keep boxing afloat. Just hoping for some better and more fruitful fights in 2017.
All right, cool. All right, there, Mike Gritty, what you got?
I thought it was the year that the fights opened up, you know, comparative to other years where we got people who didn't fight each other. You know, I think that the gates got open for the young champions to actually start fighting each other. And maybe it was because there was another, you know, competitor in the boxing realm, which was the premier boxing champions. It forced everybody else to pretty much make people fight, you know, their competitors, and instead of just doing the mismatches. Yeah, we got some mismatches, but I don't think we would have ever seen Porter Thurman. We wouldn't have seen there was a few fights that I felt like were good. Even his last fight with Julian Williams and DeCharlo, that was a pretty good fight. I mean, yeah. I thought it's probably going to compete for Fight of the Year with Premier Boxing Champions. I think that was a good way for them to end it. And, I mean, I'm glad that we got this third competitor. I agree with War Rank that, you know, things may be slowing down for Premier Boxing Champions, but at least this is making people fight each other. Who's Canelo fighting next? He's fighting...
They may be fighting Lil Chavez.
Okay. Never mind. I'm going to stop there. That just derailed my whole thought process.
All right, Terrell, what you got?
Yeah, I would, if I was to give this year in a review a grade, I would give it a B. And basically, I think this is a solid, optimistic year. I mean, we've had some disappointments with our heavyweight champion getting out of order, giving up his belts and things like that. But we've had some good fights in this year. And this year is definitely set us up for next year. I mean, we look at somebody, we have some surprises like the Lomachenko Waters fight. That was a surprise of how that went down. But going forward, we got some good pieces in place for the heavyweights. We got great pieces in place for the welterweight division. Even the weighing status of someone in 140 like Crawford. So we definitely got some excitement going into this year. It's just a matter of sitting down, putting all our boxing pieces together, different weight classes, and let's see how this puzzle plays out. From heavyweight, like I said, to 154 to 160, we had a great fight in the Ward Kovalev fight. That was a great fight. There's a lot of controversy with that. But we've had a lot of interest in boxing. Like I said, and one thing, too, this is pretty much our first full year, I think, in the post-Mayweather era, that is. So, no, and like Mike said, no more of everybody trying to call out Mayweather and get the Mayweather fight. Even Triple G's to call him out and try to give him the fight at a catch weight, which wasn't going to happen. But this is our first full year without Mayweather, even though a lot of people still think he may come back for his 50th fight, even though he said to the contrary that health is first. But so, and like Mike said, at this point now, you know what? You got to fight each other. That's why we saw Thurman Porter. That's why we saw that. That's now why we're going to see Thurman Garcia going this next year. So this year is definitely sets us up for the year into 2017. And like I said, this first quarter is going to be on fire pretty much. So we're looking good. We're looking good. And that's all you MMA people. Boxing is still good. Boxing is still on top.
True. Just to like review what has basically gone on through the year in boxing. I mean, I go through, you know, those first few months where, you know, being here in D.C., we had like a good number of fights, especially coming from like, you know, February, March through April, where we were able to see like Ortiz versus Thompson. We had that, you know, Broner fight against Ashley Theophane. You have the doubleheader in the super middleweight division that kind of led to what's coming up here in 2017 with Badu Jack and James DeGale. So we had like a few, you know, cards where we were able to see, you know, those guys kind of be showcased and, you know, other guys like, you know, Robert Easter Jr. out there, Gervonta Davis, a couple of guys to me that you may want to be on the lookout for in 2017, to kind of like move up in the ranks as far as like being noticed by more people in the sport of boxing. So I would say those two guys are, you know, on watch. And like you were, what Terrell was saying in reference to Tyson Fury, kind of like really muddling up the heavyweight division as far as like who is the top guy there, as he kind of like stepped down from having the rematch against Vladimir Klitschko and gave up most of those belts. So, you know, now we kind of like have different title holders there. I mean, you have Wilder WBC, you have Joshua there with the IBF, and you have Joseph Parker with the WBO. So we're going to kind of like see if we can get that cleared up here upcoming in 2017. The other thing is, you know, 2016 to me, kind of like clear things out as far as like the 140-pound division. We saw there Terrence Crawford is the, you know, without a shadow of a doubt, the number one guy at 140 pounds. And in 154, it looks like Jamal Charlo is the top guy there at 154 pounds. You know, we were able to see Jamal Charlo defeat Austin Trout on, I think it was May 21st in that triple header, with him, his brother, and Arizona De Lara, and then get that KO victory against Julian J. Rock Williams that we recently saw there to score pretty much, I think it was, I would say, the biggest victory in the 154-pound division. So he kind of like stepped up being the number one guy in that particular division. Middleweight kind of was kind of controlled by what Canelo was going to do or not do.
with Gennady Golovkin. So that kind of like sung out here going up into 2017. And so now we get to see what Golovkin is all about against Daniel Jacobs on March 18th. So I kind of like seeing that. And two more guys I'll kind of like mention before closing it off. You have Chocolatito Gonzalez, kind of like putting his name out there as one of the top pound-for-pound guys. Did have a very tough fight against Carlos Quadras. It may look like he's going to have a rematch against Quadras, and it might be on that March 18th card with Golovkin and Jacobs. So if that happens, that's going to make that MSG card a ticket to really try to get after and go get once it gets on sale. And the other guy is Vasyl Lomachenko. Of course, he had, you know, he had a blowout win earlier this year, and then he had that fight here against Nicholas Walters where, you know, leading up to the fight, we kind of like didn't know how that was going to turn out. But, you know, once the fight happened, he was able to blow out Nicholas Walters. So he's looking like he's, you know, one of the best guys out there. So that's pretty much what I'm saying here for the year 2016, and we're going to be looking forward to 2017 here. We're going to skip the show here next Sunday for people to enjoy the holiday season, and it may be up in the air if I do a show on January 1st because, you know, I'm kind of like a college football fan, and they're going to have the college football playoffs the night before, and then the customary January 1st games in the last week of the NFL season there. So if there's anything, it may be January 8th as far as, like, the next show goes. But in the meantime, thankful for all that is called in World Rank, Mike Grady Terrell being a key contributor to this Boxing Source radio show here in the year 2016. Looking forward to more conversations in the next year. And like I say at the end of every show, the point of boxing is to hit and not get hit, not to stand and trade. And on that note, I'm out. Go Cowboys. The Bucks suck.
When you don't go to Geico.com, car insurance can be confusing. Like Swedish techno confusing.
Bark, bark, meow, meow. Dance with me, purple cow. Bark, bark, meow, meow. Ooh, you lovely cow.
Geico makes it easy. With 24/7 access, all you have to do is go to geico.com and you could save money on car insurance. It just makes sense. Unlike, you know.
Dance with me, purple cow. I like your moves.
In this season of sharing and connecting, no gift is more perfect than a new Samsung Galaxy S7 or Galaxy S7 Edge. Unless it's two. That's right, buy one Galaxy S7 or Galaxy S7 Edge at Sprint and get a second one free, twice the nice at one low price. So dash to a Sprint store, sprint.com/holiday, or call 1-800-SPRINT-1 today and get two gifts to make spirits bright.
Coverage and offer not available everywhere, subject to credit and $30 activation fee. GS72896 and Edge 3313 per phone for 24 months with installment billing. Second phone free after monthly credits. Requires new lines. Taxes due at sale. Early termination results on remaining balance due. Excludes 50% off. Line restrictions apply.